Good morning, and welcome to First United Methodist Church. I'm Tim Roberts, the pastor, and it's such a joy for you to be able to join us in person and online. We thank you for being here today, and I got a few announcements I'd like to make, but before we do any, let me go ahead and do the call to worship. Now, you'll see in the bulletin that there is a call to worship that Helen Claire Haynes was scheduled to do. She's unable to be here today, so let me lead you in this. This is the Lord's day. This is the Lord's house. Amen. Let the praise begin, because today is a very special day. It is Children's Sabbath. And because it's Children's Sabbath, the children have a part in it. And we especially thank and welcome into this worship service the preschool, who will be blessing us today with their voices, and I know that you all will enjoy that. I got a few announcements I'd like to make before we get started. In your bulletin, as you open it up, you'll find that there's a fold-in spot. What we'd like for you to do, members and guests, please fill this out. Just let us know a little bit about yourselves and put in an offering plate as you leave. You'll find the offering plates here by each door and also in the rear. Just let us know you've been here with us today, and we'll get some information about first out to you. And if you are a guest, this is the only gift that we ask. On the back side of that, if you have any prayer concerns that you would like for the church and or me to be in prayer with you this week, please fill this out, drop it in an offering plate. If you would like everybody to be in prayer with you, please check the box midway down. Otherwise, I'm going to treat it as confidential. It will go no further than between you and me. For those of you who are watching online, you can just send me an email at troberts@wnccumc.net. You should have that. Or you can also just put it in the comment sections of the video. I do want to lift up one announcement, and I know that Robbie's got a couple he would like to, but this afternoon at 3 o'clock, we're having a grief share introduction. So if you or somebody you know who has gone through a time of grief because of the death of a loved one, we invite you to be here today at 3 o'clock as you learn a little bit about this new program that we're beginning in about a week or two called Grief Share. It is a support group that you, if you've gone through a death of a loved one or a close friend, you don't have to go through this alone. There's so many people that can help walk with you through this. Robbie? Well, friends, this is the day the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you. Let us all stand for our litany.
Oh God, we come this day to celebrate the children among us.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
We thank you, God, for creating children in your image.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
Help us, God, to honor our children and to raise them up according to the divine goodness.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
As we are called to nurture our children in the Christian faith, we pray for your divine guidance.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
Help us, God, to be intentional and loving towards all the children of our community.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
As we hear the call of Jesus to make disciples, help us to reach out to the children of our congregation, our faith community, our neighborhoods, and the world.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
Help us be good parents, guardians, role models, mentors, and servants for our children.
Thank you, God, for blessing us with children.
As we celebrate Children's Sabbath, help us hear the call of Jesus to let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs.
Amen.
And now let us continue standing as we sing together hymn number 277, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus. And now let us continue standing as we say what we believe, as we recite together the Apostles' Creed, found number 881 in your hymnal, also printed in your bulletin. And let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence you shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. And as you do, please send your children down for time, mostly for children.
Good morning, everybody. It's so good to see all these faces. Boys and girls, this is called Children's Sermon. So at our church, we'll have children's time, and sometimes we have to get some adults to come down here. But today we have so many happy kids' faces. Well, I have a hard question for you. It's really hard. Some of the older ones might be the only ones who know the answer. How many of you know what the word adapt means? Brinkley, I knew you would. What does it mean to adapt? To get used to something or to change. So did y'all know that God has given us the ability as people to change and to adapt? Animals can adapt, plants can change, and we can change. So like when it gets really cold and snowy, did y'all know that there's some animals whose fur will change color? It'll change to white in the winter so that the animals that like to eat them can't find them. And plants can change. For instance, have you ever seen a plant in your house change directions when the sun changes? And you know what else? People can change. We've had to change a lot these past couple years because of that thing called COVID. We've had to change the way we do things. Sometimes we have to wear masks. Sometimes we have to stay home from school. Sometimes we have to quarantine by ourselves. It's been really weird, but we have changed. One thing that we haven't done so well with this change is trying to be together and still loving each other. For instance, I had my mask on a little bit ago, and I saw my old buddy Matt over here, and I'm smiling away. I'm smiling at Matt right now. Can you tell I'm smiling at you, Matt? No, so I had to do this. But then Matt knew I was happy to see him because I waved at him. So sometimes we're at the grocery store. If you have your mask on, I'm kind of like, oh, good, I have my mask on. I don't have to talk to anybody. I'm not in the mood to talk to anybody. I can have a pimple and nobody will see because I have my mask on. And I just kind of hide. But you know what? I've gotten into the habit of doing that. Even sometimes at church I come in and I'm like, oh, reading Lulu, we're late getting ready for church. They put me in a bad mood. I don't really want to talk to anybody. I'm just going to keep my mask on and sit right here. Is that a good thing of me to do? No. So I need to keep changing and making sure, even if I have my mask on, or even if these habits I've gotten into, that I'm still waving to people, then I'm still making an effort to talk to people. Maybe I have to get up out of my seat, or maybe I have to wave. So one thing I want us to do this week, whether you have a mask on or not, is to try to make an effort to be really nice to people. And I want to tell you what, this is a church community. So whether you go to this church on Sundays or whether you go to preschool here, you are part of this church family. And boys and girls, I want you to look at all the people sitting here. Look at all these faces. You probably don't know a lot of these faces. Look behind you. Look at Pastor Tim. You might not even know him, but I'll tell you what, he loves you, and he prays for all of you. And a lot of these people sitting out here, even if you don't know them, they pray for you. They are happy you're here because they're part of your church family. So what we're going to do, so that all these people who love you can see you, we're going to stand up and we're going to walk together. We're going to go up and down all these aisles. And you can smile, or you can do this, or you can even touch somebody on the arm. But as we're walking, you do something to let these people know that you love them and that we are all part of God's family, okay? So we'll walk around together, and then you can go back to your seats, all right? So let's do that. I'll lead, and everybody do follow the leader. Thank you so much, boys and girls. Everyone is happy to see you waving. You can go back to your seats now. And while they are, I'm going to say the prayer for children in your bulletin. Great God, guard of the laughter of children, bring them safely through injury and illness so they may live the promises you give. Do not let us be so preoccupied with our purposes that we fail to hear their voices or pay attention to their special vision of the truth. But keep us with them, ready to listen and to love, even as in Jesus Christ you have loved us, your grown-up wayward children.
Thank you.
If you've been a guest, if you're a guest with us today, you probably picked up your bulletin and you went, oh my gosh, how long is this going to take? I promise you it won't be that long. In your bulletin today, you received a whole packet of things, and the biggest bulk of it is this packet that's got a paperclip on it, and it is just this week's insert to a book that any of you who do not have it, you may pick one up if you like. This is our Journal for Daily Transformation. We put a packet in each week. It goes along with the sermon series that we're doing right now, and each week we have a little bit more in-depth reading and also daily our daily GPS, which is our guide to prayer and scripture. So it's got a prayer, a section of scripture for you to read, and some things to think about. So if you'd like to pick this up, you may do so. There's some right over here. There's some in the back that you can pick up if you like, and you just add this in with it. And even if you're not planning on coming back until the next time the children sing again, you're still welcome to take one. But this week, today we're continuing in this series that we're calling 10 Habits of Holy Living. And in it, we've been considering some of the different disciplines that people have developed over the last couple of thousand years to help them grow in their faith. But before we do that, before we get into this week's, I want us to go together and to God in prayer and ask God to bless us as we consider not only this discipline, but just everything about today, God's presence with us. So what I'd like for you to do is I'd like for you to hold out your hands, palms up, as we assume a posture of expectancy and pray this prayer with me. Lord, I offer myself to you. Open my ears to hear and my heart to receive all you have for me today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, let's just dive right into it. We're going to look at a discipline that that someone or some group of people a couple thousand years ago really thought that this would be a good way to grow closer to Jesus. And it actually predates Jesus. And it is the discipline of fasting. Fasting. I mean, that sounds like a delicious discipline for us to pick up, right? I mean, what exactly is fasting? Well, as I normally do, whenever I ask this question, I always have the answer because I go to my friend, dear Mr. Webster, to find out exactly what he defines as this term. And this is what Mr. Webster said. He said, fasting is the willful refrainment from eating and sometimes drinking. Now, there are many different ways that we may fast. One of the ways that probably many of you have fasted before is for health. When we fast, sometimes it helps control our blood sugar levels. It may fight inflammation. It may enhance blood pressure. It may enhance our triglycerides and our cholesterol levels. And it sometimes boosts our brain function. And whenever I said this to my wife, she says, you need to fast a whole lot more. Sometimes we fast for a diet because we want to lose weight, and so we will skip certain meals so that we will reduce our caloric intake. But what we're really looking at today is the spiritual reason for fasting. Now, some people have tried to tie the spiritual and the diet together. You know, they say, I want to get closer to Jesus, but I would really like to work on my beach bod at the same time. But somehow that just doesn't seem to be too spiritual right there, does it? So let's look at it for spiritual reasons. Why should we do this? Well, the answer really comes from to us in today's scripture lesson. It comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17, verses 14 through 22. And it begins like this. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. Jesus replied, O unbelieving and perverse generation, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy, and the boy was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, why couldn't we drive the demon out? Now, did you notice that the disciples are pretty frustrated at this moment? I mean, think about it. They had been following Jesus for some time by now. They had been watching everything he did. They had been listening and soaking in all of this wisdom from Jesus. And then they had been charged and empowered by Jesus to go out and to do the same things that he did. But when they tried, their efforts flopped, and they felt like complete failures. So finally, someone who had sought these disciples' help, to no avail, as you recall, comes up to Jesus and says, hey, Jesus, I need your help because I came to your guys here and they can't do what you did. Well, Jesus finally speaks. And his first words in this passage are these. Oh, unbelieving and perverse generation, how long shall I stay with you? Now, although these people had studied under him, Jesus called them perverse. Or that is, he was calling them a people who seemed defiant to learn and to follow. So, in other words, teachers, you'll understand this. They were stubborn. He has given them all the authority to heal, but they just don't seem to grasp that they can. They should have been able to perform this act of healing, not in their own power, but through the power of Jesus, yet they don't. So they ask why. And Jesus brings it down to the very basic tenet, faith. In verse 20 says this, because you have so little faith, I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Now, I don't know about you, but I think I've got at least the faith of a mustard seed. But I'm quite sure that if I go to South Mountain and say, South Mountain, I want you to move from south to north, it's not going to do it. And so for me to hear these words, it doesn't even begin to compare to what the disciples were hearing. They were with him. They had been charged by him. He had laid his hands on them and charged them and commissioned them to do these things, and they can't. So these words were hard to hear and even more hard to swallow. And three of them had just had this mountaintop experience with Jesus and thought that it couldn't get any better than that. And they wanted to stay there. But Jesus wouldn't let them. So now here they are, down in the valley, and they're feeling defeated and humiliated. But I want you to notice something. It's here that the opportunity to learn was the greatest. Think about it. When do you learn those principles that go on to shape the essence of your lives? Do you really learn them when you're on that mountaintop high, when everything is good? Or do they really sink in when we're down in the valley and we have to graduate from the school of hard knocks? Jesus indicates that faith is the key to not only possessing the power that he gives, but also being able to utilize it. And the source of that faith is revealed in verse 21. Now, for anybody who's out there following along on your in your Bible, in your Bible app, you may note that verse 21 is missing. It seems that there are certain translations of the Bible where it goes directly from verse 20 to verse 22. And in those situations, if you take a look, usually the verse 21 is down as a footnote. The footnote means that the verse is not in the main body of the text because it is found only in some of the oldest manuscripts. Now, if you were here a few weeks ago or if you saw it online, you may remember that we were talking about, when we were talking about Bible studies, that some of our translations, such as the King James Version, is not the oldest of the translations, or it may not go back to the oldest, it does not go back to the oldest sources for translations. And so it does not have everything that some of the others has, or it may be a little bit different. But listen, even though this text is not included in some of our old manuscripts, it is consistent with the life and practice of Jesus. Remember, before Jesus ever took his life purpose, he spent 40 days praying and fasting in the desert. So what does verse 21 say? What says this? This kind of faith does not go out except by prayer and fasting. You see, what verse 21 says is that this stubborn, resistant behavior, when we remain stubborn, it puts a whooping on us, on our spiritual lives, because it keeps us from realizing our full God-given potential. The only way that we can fully embrace our God-given faith is through prayer and fasting. And when many of us think of prayer and fasting, sometimes we think, okay, I'm going to try this pray and fasting for Jesus. And it begins pretty well, but sometime around breakfast time, our stomachs start to growl, and we become miserable. And so we think, oh, well, I may be miserable, but I'm making God happy. God must be happy because I'm denying myself and sacrificing. Yet, I can't wait till this fast is over so I can stuff my face. You see, we have a perverse, and yeah, I'm going to use that word Jesus used here. We have this perverse idea that prayer and fasting is all about denial and sacrifice and suffering. But brothers and sisters, it's not. Prayer and fasting is about power. It's about empowerment to realize your life purpose and potential in God's plan. And there is nothing that I can think of that's more disheartening for a Christian than not realize one purpose and potential in God's plan. This text that we had just read spoke about a demon who had possessed a young boy and attempted to destroy his life. Now, friends, demons still try to destroy lives. I mean, they may not be out walking around in circles trying to conjure up some way to wreak havoc on our lives, because they don't need to do that. They have a much easier course. All they have to do is convince you that you have not been empowered to do the works of Jesus. They just have to keep you from realizing that your purpose and potential in God's plan, and it's that simple. That's why prayer and fasting must become a habit for us. Now, there are some different schools of thought on how often we should fast. And personally, I say that's up to you to discern for yourself. Now, some people will fast for a whole day each week. Some people will fast only certain meals. And others will fast only when they're truly seeking God's guidance for some monumental decision that they're trying to make, or for repentance for their sin, or on behalf of the sins of some people. And there's a biblical basis for all of these, but when you fast, it's truly up for you to decide. And maybe you're wondering more about how a Christian should fast. And there are different ways to do that. Some people avoid delicacies such as chocolate. Some people eat less than usual. Some people will avoid all food but will drink liquids, such as dear Mr. Wesley, who was the founder of our movement. He was a good British man, so he would fast, but he was going to have his tea each day. Now some people abstain from all food and drink. Now, this is an exception. It's not something that the normal person could or should do, because people really shouldn't go more than a couple of days without any liquid intake. But it may not just be in relation to food or drink. Some people will fast from media. They will give up TV. They'll give up radio. They'll give up internet. Some people will avoid doing some things that bring pleasure. But whenever and however we fast, we don't just give these things up and move on to the next thing that we would have done on our daily basis. During this time that we're giving something up, we fill that void with prayer. So if you're giving up a meal, you take that 20 minutes that you would have been eating and fill it with prayer. If it is surfing the internet, you take that 3 to 4 hours and you fill it with prayer. You see, the point is, it's less about me and more about God. And how you fast really depends on the purpose of the fast. When you fast for spiritual reasons, you discover the things that have become substitute for God in your life. Let's say I fast for a day. And when I fast from eating, it's usually for 24 hours. And when lunchtime comes around, I'm thinking Big Mac, because my stomach's been neglected. Instead of concentrating on that ache and thinking of what I don't have, I use that ache to remind me that my real hunger is for God's presence in my life. That's why we fast. Now, let me close out with this one thought to ponder. If giving something up for a determined period of time means I can get closer with God, why wouldn't I do it? Let's pray. Gracious God, many of us have fasted, and sometimes we try to fast and it's for the wrong reasons. We try to make a show, maybe not for other people, but for ourselves. We try to prove our worthiness to you and say, look at me, God, how I'm hurting, but I'm hurting for you. But as we fast, Father, help us to use this time not to focus on what we're missing, but what we're gaining. When we bypass something that brings us pleasure, our body's pleasure, our mind pleasure, help us to remember that what we are doing now is we're spending time with you. And that brings a holistic pleasure. For we're at the threshold of grace. So help us consider making this a habit. Whatever that may look like and how often that looks like, Lord, you work within each of us. But in all things, God, let this draw us closer to you. And we pray this in the name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, my brothers and sisters, let's close out this time of worship with hymn number 399, Take My Life and Let It Be. And receive this now, your benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, upon us all, and give us peace. Amen.